Hello, everybody. What a wonderful tonight to be here with all these wonderful people. We have our own Bernie, Senator Leahy, Mr. Donovan, and Sue and Dave, and all of you wonderful folks. My name is Dottie Ricks. I am one that answered the call to the revolution, and I am running for the Vermont House in Barrytown, which is a strong, strong Republican district, and I'm shaking my fist in their face and going for it. I am very fortunate to have been endorsed by Bernie Sanders, and I thank him for that. I've done over 1,000 calls down at the Democratic office for Sue and Dave and other state candidates, and I walk Barrytown, which is Republican, and what's so encouraging is there are so many people that are undecided, so they are not definitely Republican, and there's where we get our foot in the door. I want to give a quick call out to Rights and Democracy. They were the first group that endorsed me. I couldn't have run this campaign. I wouldn't have had a campaign without them. They've been there supporting me, gave me my magnificent campaign manager, and have helped me every which way. They are grassroots group for economic and social justice, and I hope you'll check them out. So just very quickly, I want to tell you why I'm here tonight. I am here tonight because I want to see the kind of world that I believe in, and that is one where children are cared for and are safe, are supported by their communities. That's one where adults have meaningful, fulfilling jobs and make enough money so they only have to have one job. They don't have to work two and three and can spend quality time with their families. I want a world like Dr. Martin Luther King said, where a person is not judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. And that is so whether they're in front of a building in Chicago or at a stop sign in Vermont. I want an environment that is safe and nurturing, where the water we drink is pure and we know that the air is clean and our food is wholesome. All of these people here, and there are many more out in the audience that I will introduce, support that. And I think you support that dream of a life. We've begun it here in Vermont. We cannot backslide. We cannot let people get in office that will revoke what we've worked so hard to get. So right now I want to have folks that are candidates for office that are in the audience to stand up. I will call out their name. You stand and wave. Please hold your applause until after everyone stood up. So first I'm doing senators. We have candidate Anthony Polina, Mark McDonald, George Gay. And I think that's all of my senators. We have folks from the House. We have Janet Ansel. We have Avram Pat. Kimberly Jessup. Theron Wood. Tom Stevens. Dottie Ricks, Warren Kitzmiller, and Chip Triano. So what I want to remind you about all of these people is that that without all of these local people, our state people will not be able to get their work done. So we need to go out, we need to support all of these local people and our state people so that we'll be able to keep that kind of world that we want. So now I have the incredible honor of introducing a man here that does not need to be introduced, our local homegrown hero, Senator Bernie Sanders. Good job.
Thank you. Thanks, everybody. Thank you. Thank you all for coming out to do something fairly radical, and that is to practice democracy. And as you know, nationally, democracy is in fact being threatened by Citizens United and by billionaires all over this country who intend to do everything they can to buy elections. And in Vermont, we are saying you are not going to buy this election. Democracy will prevail. Now, before I introduce this wonderful slate of candidates, I just want to pick up on a point that Dottie made. And that is, as Americans living in the wealthiest country in the history of the world, we have the right to fight to create the kind of state and nation that we know we can become. Our job is to think big, not small, and to work together in a democratic way to transform this country and to have the courage to take on a billionaire class whose greed is doing so much harm. Are we prepared to do that? There is no rational economic reason why so few have so much, and yet working people in Montpelier or Barrie cannot find high-quality, affordable childcare. Young people cannot afford to go to the college of their dreams. People in this state are working two or three jobs, in many cases, to cobble together the income and the health care that they require. Our job is to bring that day closer, where health care is a right of all people, where public colleges and universities are tuition free, where we create nationally millions of good-paying jobs, rebuilding our crumbling infrastructure, and where we lead the world, and this state can lead this country, in transforming our energy system and combating climate change. Our job in the next several weeks is to get this very, very strong slate of candidates elected, and the day after the election, continue our efforts to make sure that the needs of working families and the elderly and the children are in fact heard. Let me begin the evening by introducing to you a gentleman who has done, in my view, a very important work in an area that is not necessarily sexy. And that is work to reinvigorate our democracy, to do everything that we can to make it easier for people to participate, as opposed to states around the country where we have governors making it harder for people to participate. Please welcome our Secretary of State, Jim Condos.
Thank you. And I couldn't echo those comments any more than what Bernie already said, but I do want to say that my office and myself have been dealing with national press for the last week, week and a half, about rigged elections and voter fraud. So I thought I'd talk to you folks about that tonight. As Vermont's chief election officer, I and my team have been working to improve and maintain the integrity of our elections. Vermont's elections will not be rigged. There is no voter fraud. And we'll go on into a little bit of that. We take very seriously any discussion about rigged elections. I'm confident in the work that our team has done, our town clerks who are on the front lines, and their election, local election officials, to protect that integrity of our electoral process. And I can tell you that we've taken many precautions. We've worked hard to secure our systems and our data via cyber risk assessment, penetration tests, and firewalls. We are on high alert, and we're in constant communication with both the FBI and Homeland Security. And we will respond to any threats that we see. Our system of elections in most of the country is decentralized. And when people talk about the vote tabulators, they keep, I've had to try to explain this to the press, and they've really had a tough time understanding it, but our vote tabulators are self-contained units that are not connected to the internet by hardwire, by Wi-Fi. They are separate units operating on their own. The information is taken from that by a tape. That tape and the ballots, which we in Vermont have a mandate that we must have a ballot at the end of the day, both of those are sealed in a bag and kept for 22 months. We also do a random audit of several towns, top to bottom, of their entire election within 30 days of the election. In case no one noticed, I am mindful that we have an election coming up. And the suppression of that voter participation across the country that is occurring, that is all in the name of one thing. It's called voter fraud. Well, I'm here to tell you that the true voter fraud in this country is denying any American or any Vermonter who is eligible to vote from being able to vote. That's the true voter fraud. Vermont and the legislature has done an awful lot in the last 10 years to expand our ability to vote, make it easier to vote. We have things called, well, same-day voter registration has been approved, but it won't go into effect until next January. We have automatic voter registration, which will take effect next July. We are the fourth state in the country that has passed automatic voter registration, where people who go to DMV will automatically be registered. And I'm reminded of one thing when people talk about voter fraud. Folks, we have a tough enough time getting people to vote once, never mind twice. So to wrap up, I'm just going to state that I'm really confident in our democratic process. I'm confident in our elections process here in the state of Vermont. I'm excited about the work that my team has done, that the town clerks are doing at their level, and we're going to have a great election. Thank you.
Everybody, whether you're conservative or progressive, wants to make sure that our tax dollars are spent cost effectively and wisely. Doug Hoffer is our auditor of accounts. He is doing a great job. Doug, come on up.
Thank you, Bernie. I'm not going to talk about the work of my office. That's not what you want to hear. I'm not Auditor Doug. I'm Citizen Doug tonight. I came to Vermont almost 30 years ago to work for Bernie and Peter Clavel in City Hall in Burlington. How lucky is that? And, you know, in addition to the truly groundbreaking work which continues on affordable housing and the reclamation of the waterfront and so many other things, I think really the hallmark of his tenure was the refreshing expansion of the discourse. New ideas, everything was on the table, and to me, that is really a litmus test of leadership. And if we look at that measure and contrast the two candidates for governor this year, the difference couldn't be more stark. Phil Scott seems to care primarily about the size of state government and doesn't talk very much about what government actually does for the people of this state. And that's troubling to me. He does, in fact, sometimes you hear echoes in his remarks of Ronald Reagan, who told us that government is the problem. And that troubles me also. He does talk about finding efficiencies in government, and that's okay, but that's not a vision. In contrast, Sue Minter has a very positive vision for this state, and she talks often about the importance of using and investing public resources and leveraging them to solve problems. That's what you want in a governor, somebody who's passionate about identifying and solving problems, and that's what she wants to do, and that's what we need. So there's a whole bunch of good people here to speak tonight. You don't need to hear from me. We got to work hard to get her elected. All of us, but especially Sue. Thank you.
Thank you, Doug. State treasurer, an enormously important position, investing many, many millions of dollars, among other jobs. Please welcome Treasurer Beth Pierce.
Down a little lower. Okay, so first I just want to say that I am honored to be with all of you tonight and with the best candidates you can possibly find all across the country, right? Okay. Let's start over here with the best congressional delegation in the country. They're fantastic, all of them. And tonight I really want to say thank you to Senator Sanders for all the work that you've done and all the dialogue that you've had across the country. I will tell you that he is our senator, he's my senator, he's been great for Vermont, he's been great for veterans, he's been great in getting that message out. I will tell you his speech, his ability to talk straight and get the issues out there and be an advocate for the people has made me a better treasurer, and I'm very proud of you and very proud of the work that you've done. Thank you for helping me be a better treasurer. Now, as I talk about the treasurer's office, and I'm not going to go into, you know, I spent the day talking to actuaries, and you probably don't want to hear about that, okay? But our bottom line is important, and how we manage the state's finances are very important. And I spend an awful lot of time on that, and my job is to make it as efficient as possible, to make it good, and have economic prosperity, and do all the right things in terms of smart investments. That is extraordinarily important. But it also has to have a bottom line that is fair and equitable for every single Vermonter. And we need to have a goal of financial prosperity, of dignity in retirement, and a goal of having a lifetime of financial security and financial well-being for every single Vermonter. To that end, we've talked about a couple of things in the last year. We do a lot of good work, and I want to talk about three things. One is dignity in retirement. Every person who has worked so hard in their careers has a right to adequate and reliable income in retirement. That's good for the economy because when they have adequate and reliable income, they buy goods and services and they're part of the economic generator. They have a right to dignity in retirement. I manage the pension funds for 50,000 Vermonters. the municipal system, the state system, and the teacher system. Every single one of those individuals who've been public service has a right to that dignity and retirement. Folks, talk about, what about the other folks? There are 104,000, according to AARP, 104,000 Vermonters who do not have access to employer-sponsored retirement plans. And we need to fix that. We're working on that. I'm chairing a committee on that. We will be bringing a proposal to a legislature that will be responsive to that if we do the right thing on Election Day. We're also involved in local investments, taking more of our dollars. And thank you, Senator Sanders, for talking to me about that again and again. We've got $33 million. We call it 10% in Vermont. We've got $33 million invested locally. Take it out of Wall Street. Bring it here. Invest in farms. Invest in child care. Invest in housing and energy. Investing in all of the important pieces of our legacy, our state, the fabric of our state. And I want to thank you very much for all you've done there in bringing that issue across the country. I also want to say thank you to all the legislators, because it's a partnership. We get this done in partnership. I know that Senator Polina was very involved in that, Representative Bozzo and Bennington. We all work together to get these things done, and to work together to help every single Vermonter find that prosperity. To do that, we gotta get the legislators that have stood up tonight elected, and we've gotta elect these two people. Let's get that done. We gotta elect Sue Minter, and we've gotta elect, there's three back there, I can count, okay? All right. Okay, David Zuckerman and TJ Donovan, we gotta get them elected. Now, when we talk about shared prosperity, we all have the same message. When I talk about it from a financial side, Doug talks about it from an accountability side, Jim Condos talks about it from a side of involving every citizen, engaging every citizen in transparency, and in letting them take part of the process. Our candidates here, TJ, talks about it from restorative justice and doing the right things in the justice system. Our leaders here, Dave Zuckerman and Sue Minter, they embody all of those ideals. We've got to get this team elected. We need your help. Vote on November 8th, vote Democrat, and get out there and get your friends out there too. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
One of the great crises that our country is wrestling with right now is a broken criminal justice system. It is a system which today has more people in jail than any other country on earth by far, and it's a system which is locking up 2.2 million Americans at a cost of $80 billion a year at the local, state, and federal level. The role of Attorney General is enormously important in terms of law enforcement, but also in terms of making sure that we are not just sending people to jail, but in fact we are doing everything that we can to keep from sending people to jail. And I think our next speaker, T.J. Donovan, understands that very well. Let's elect him Attorney General. T.J.
Thank you, Senator Sanders. I want to thank you as a candidate for your endorsement, but as a Burlington boy who grew up in the Queen City during the time of your term as mayor of that city, it is an honor to have your support and to watch your career not only in this state, but how you have changed this nation. Thank you, Senator Sanders. And I want to thank you for speaking out about inequality in the criminal justice system. Senator Leahy, as a former prosecutor, knows this. I know this as state's attorney. that the best form of anti-poverty work we can do in this state is to reform our criminal justice system. The poor and the people of color do not have a monopoly on committing crime, but those are the folks who are in our jails and in our courthouses every single day. When the state of Vermont spends more money in our Department of Corrections than we do on higher education, we have misplaced priorities in this state, and it needs to change. And let me tell you another thing that needs to change. We need to ban private prisons in this state. The state of Vermont should not be contracting with a corporation to incarcerate Vermonters. And we can do it. We can do it, as Beth Pierce said, by investing in restorative justice and not just punitive justice. As Attorney General, I'll lead the effort to make sure that we have one system of justice, not 14 different systems of justice in this state. And here's how we're gonna do it. We're gonna redefine what public safety means in the 21st century. And it starts with access to healthcare. And universal prenatal care for every woman and child is in the interest of public safety. Early childhood education is in the interest of public safety. Robust mental health services in our public schools is in the interest of public safety, not just for children, but their entire families. Affordable housing is in the interest of public safety. Affordable higher education is in the interest of public safety. And good jobs with decent wages is in the interest of public safety. When we talk about leveling the playing field, let's leave nobody behind. Let's start by reforming our criminal justice system and giving everybody an opportunity for success in this state. This is why I'm running for Attorney General. Thank you for your support.
Thank you, TJ. I must confess that I have known David Zuckerman for a very, very long time. And when I first met him in Burlington, he was busy registering thousands of young people to vote. He was working like a dynamo then. He hasn't stopped. Let's elect David Zuckerman, our next Lieutenant Governor. David.
Thank you, Bernie. It's true. I was an activist student at the University of Vermont. I was pretty cynical about the corporate influence in politics back in 1992. So I think it's pretty understandable that a lot of young people today are even more cynical about politics than I was then. But I was inspired by this incredible individual who then was a one-term congressman running for re-election, and he gave to me what he has given to millions and millions of people across this country. The idea of what democracy can stand for, of what politicians, and I prefer to call us publicly elected officials, what publicly elected officials can do when you stand up for what's right, you don't go negative, you don't accept corporate contributions, and you lead the way on issues of economic justice, social justice, and environmental justice. Thank you, Bernie, for being such an amazing leader for all of us. Now, I also have to give a shout out to the gentleman to his right, to the left from your perspective. What's right and left anyway, right? I remember around the kitchen table growing up, my mom talking about a senator from Vermont who was always one of the most civil and dignified people in all of the 535 people in Washington. And it's been a real honor and pleasure to be a constituent of his since I came here for college in 1989, and to watch his dignified leadership on so many issues of justice in the judicial system, justice for our farmers and agriculture, affordable housing, justice, just simply justice itself. Let's give it up for Senator Leahy, an incredible leader in this country. And if I could say a couple words about our lone congressman in the House. Probably one of the most difficult jobs in the country today, outside of being someone who works to clean buildings at night as janitors, or who's serving us food, people who do the day-to-day grind to just make a living. This guy's got to go down and work with, let's say he's working down in the sewers, I guess, in Washington, trying to clean up the mess that the U.S. House of Representatives continues to put upon us. How he has the patience to do what he does is quite remarkable. But what's even more remarkable is his ability to find issues where he can still reach across that aisle and be successful for Vermonters and folks across this country. Thank you, Peter Welch, for your incredible service. Now, I had the pleasure the other night to be down in Windsor County and really listen to our three folks who are running for re-election. And it was just so refreshing when you look at the national level of sort of what's not happening. And look at these three individuals who are probably the most suited for their job of just about anybody I know in terms of their skill sets and their values and actually the role of the job, which is, frankly, not partisan jobs at all, what they're doing. And they get elected, and they go down there and do that job so well, expanding voters' rights, keeping track of your hard-earned dollars and how they're spent in our government, and making sure those dollars that we have invested for our future and our retirement, as well as just general operating cash flow and debt and bonds, they do it, bar none, better than any other three in the country. Let's thank them. Now, I just want to say that what is the future that we all believe in? What is the revolution that we are all a part of here in Vermont that Bernie has inspired the rest of the country for? Does that revolution include dignity and a livable wage of $15 an hour? Does it? Yes, it does. Does it include the basic rights of individuals to have affordable housing? How radical is that? Does it include both, and this one's kind of personal, paying farmers for their work, but also making sure healthy food is available for all families and children? Because we know when children are fed well, they do better in school, and they then thrive to be our future as parts of this grand system we have in our economy. Why, and what we've done here in Vermont to improve the quality of school food between Farm to School, which celebrated its 10th anniversary this year, and also making free meals available to all children that need them so that they have full bellies in the classroom, because sometimes those are the only two meals they get, is that free breakfast and lunch. how can we, as Bernie pointed out, in the wealthiest country in the history of the world, not have an economy that makes it so that our children can have 3 meals a day? That's what we all believe in here in this room. That's that common value that brings everybody here together and so many people around the country together with Bernie's message around that economic justice fundamentals of food, shelter, education, and health care. Is that really too much to ask? I don't think so. So what we have in this next 2 weeks, the people in this room, you have to recognize that the election is going to be won or lost on the energy that everybody here puts in these next couple of weeks. And I just want you to reflect on the amount of energy that our senator here has spent for the last year, every day waking up somewhere, who knows where, probably doesn't even know what bed he woke up in some days, saying, where am I today? Traveling this country, fighting for you and me. And if we can't dig deep for just the next 20-odd days, 18 days? I don't even know anymore. I can't keep track. Not many more. To make those phone calls, to go out on the street and hand out a little bit of literature for the next governor of our state, Sue Minter. To get everybody out there and say, why aren't you voting? What do you need? Are you registered? No, here's how. You can go right on your smartphone and go to the Secretary of State website and register to vote. If everybody in this room gets 5 people more, that will turn the tide. That will make the tide that we just learned about, which is tremendously amazing, into a victory. And that's what these rallies are about. That's the work that RAD is doing, organizing people all over the state for this weekend and for the last many months to get more people registered. I want to ask you, are you going to commit right now to find 5 people to register to vote or to get off the cynicism bandwagon and vote so that we can win in Vermont and send a message to Washington and everywhere else that Koch money's not going to win elections and that we're going to stand up for basic dignity for all Vermonters? Thank you very much.
There are, last I counted, 50 states in the United States. And we are proud to live in the best of those states. And what we know is that what happens today in one state, the good ideas that are developed in one state, whether it is higher education or the environment or childcare and healthcare, spreads like wildfire all over this country. Ever since I have been in politics, elected a position since 1981, my dream has always been that this small state will lead the nation in a very different direction with a very different set of priorities. Our job is to create a state, as David just said, where all of our people have health care, have educational opportunity, have decent jobs, where our farmers are well paid, producing good quality food, where people know each other, are concerned about each other, and where we treat each other civilly. We can be the model for America. But to create that vision, to become that model, we need high quality leadership. And let me introduce to you the next governor of the state who will give us that leadership, Sue Minter.
much for being here. Wow, it is exciting, you know, to be on this stage with incredible people, to realize the breadth of engagement we have in this state and in this community and in this room. Thank you. I have to recognize how much I look forward and appreciate the incredible fiscal management of our state treasurer, Beth Pierce. I don't just want to be another tall person on the stage. I want to have another woman in the house. I am so glad that it's citizen Doug Hoffer today, because when it's auditor Doug Hoffer and I'm the governor, I know we're going to have some tough conversations, and he's going to keep me on a straight and even line. Thank you, Doug. And the importance of free and fair elections. We can be so proud of the work we do, leading in many ways. Thank you for making sure our elections are clean. Thank you, Jim Condos. TJ, you are an incredible inspiration. You are a great leader, not just now, but into the future, because we know that the goal is going to be education, not incarceration. And David Zuckerman, I just have to say, I can't wait to have your organizational skills, your drive, your energy, and your ponytail in my cabinet. It is such an honor to be here on the stage with our congressional delegation. They are so extraordinary, and you know this, but I never understood until I was sort of thrust into the eye of Tropical Storm Irene what a team they are of advocates for us. And the things that they do, you have no idea. We are so fortunate, and I am so honored, and I'm so looking forward to working with all three of you to continue to move our state forward. You know, I especially am honored, of course, and so excited to be here with Bernie. You know, for me and for so many, Bernie, it's your vision and your tenacity that has inspired me throughout my public service and for all of us engaged in this great state and our democracy. Thank you, Bernie, for changing the course of our national conversation, for making social and economic justice the center of our political agenda, for fighting for Main Street and not Wall Street, for making it a priority to rebuild our middle class. As governor, I am going to work hard to carry on Bernie's fight to bring livable wage jobs and economic opportunity and hope for Vermont's struggling middle class. And that's why I am so proud to have Bernie Sanders' endorsement to be the next governor of this great state of Vermont. Thank you. And I am so glad that all of you are here tonight, because this is a very important election. Vermonters have a lot at stake. And right now, we all know, and we are all here because we know, that too many Vermont children are in poverty. Too many of our families are in shelters. Too many of our students are saddled with debt. Many of our communities reeling from an opiate epidemic. We know that our beautiful Lake Champlain is dying, and that there are 200 families in Bennington with poisoned well water. It is 80 degrees in October, and I think it's fair to say that climate change is not just here, it not just real, it is here and it is now. And it is why we are here together, because we know we can and we must change this story. We are also here because we believe in Vermont. As Bernie said, what a model we can be and already are and have been throughout our history. And it is because of what is capable when we are all in. And you know what? We cannot afford a governor who wants to put the pause button on progress. We need a governor who is ready to create an economy that is for all of Vermonters. Well, I'm in, all in. Are you all in? Because we have a choice in this election. You have a choice in this election for your governor. Do you want someone whose economic development strategy is about giving tax breaks to wealthy and corporations, or a leader who wants to invest in our communities and create livable wage jobs? For your governor, do you want someone who opposed paid sick leave, or a leader who wants to have paid family leave? Do you want a governor who talks all the time about affordability, but has no plans for affordable childcare or affordable college? Or do you want a leader who is ready to give 2 years tuition-free to community or technical college and give our students a chance for economic security in their future? And let me just say this at a time when there is a national war on women being waged in this country, with 400 bills introduced in legislatures to restrict a woman's right to choose at this time in history. Do you want a governor of Vermont who is recommended by Vermont's Right to Life Committee? Or do you want a leader who will stand strong and firm for a woman's right to choose without exception? Thank you. With the weather outside and the winter of last year, the one that wasn't, the one that so many people struggled with, the economy that didn't happen, at this time, do you want for your governor someone who has actually questioned whether climate change is really man-made? Or do you want a leader who understands that climate change is here and has plans and ready and energy to address them? I just want to ask, at this time, when we have seen over the last year an epidemic of gun violence throughout our state, and when over 85% of Vermonters believe in background checks, do you want for your governor a leader who says our gun laws are just fine? Or do you want a leader who will stand up to the gun lobby and pass common sense background checks to keep our communities safe? Thank you. So, there are just 2 weeks left. And this election, the stakes are incredibly high, and it is neck and neck. And you and I both know that Vermont is great. Vermont has never stopped being great, and together we can continue to move our state forward. Together, we can create great downtowns, livable wage jobs, while protecting our environment and investing in our green economy. Together, we can create affordable health care, affordable housing, and best in the nation education for all Vermonters. Together, we will create an economy that allows young people the opportunity to live, work, and stay in the state that they love. But here's the thing. Here's the thing. The National Republican Party and the Koch brothers are pouring millions of dollars into this election to stop us. Over $2 million already spent. And you know what? We have a message for them. Vermont is not for sale. Thank you. So I think you all know the polls are neck and neck. And we absolutely cannot let up now. We have been going this direction far too long to let ourselves subside. The greatest resource in this election is you. And we need your help now more than ever. We need your contributions. We need you to sign up tonight, to volunteer, to make phone calls, to door knock. We're doing it all over the state every single night. And it is the issue that the way that we're going to win this election. We need you to have conversations with your colleagues, with your neighbors. Yes, and we need you to vote. And remember, every day is election day because of Jim Condos. I'm just going to end by saying, because I can't help it, that I am here because in 225 years of Vermont history, we've only ever elected one woman governor. I'm ready to be the second, and I hope you are ready for me. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sue. There was once a time, not so long ago, when the Republican Party was sane. And in our own state, we had leaders like George Aiken, Bob Stafford, Jim Jeffords, Dean Davis, Dick Mallory, and others, people who were conservative, but we're concerned about education, we're concerned about the environment, we're concerned about justice. Peter Welch has the misfortune of living in a world in the U.S. House where those values no longer hold. He works in a chamber where the leadership wants to cut Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, and education, and health care, and give enormous tax breaks to billionaires and large corporations. That is where the U.S. House of Representatives is. And in the midst of all of that, year after year, year after year after year, PETA has maintained Vermont values and Vermont dignity and has done an extraordinary job in representing the state. Please welcome Congressman Peter Welch.
Thank you. and it's great to be here on a Friday night with all Vermonters getting ready for an election that's less than almost 2 weeks away, a little more. Bernie Sanders, I want to say a couple of things, and then I want to address this concern that David Zuckerman expressed and Bernie expressed about my life working with some of the best minds of the 17th century. You know, Bernie said at the beginning that the radical proposition that we're here to embody is that we're here to practice democracy. And think about, you know, the spectacle of this campaign. You don't need me, you don't need anyone else to tell you that it's astonishing how much political deviance is dumbed down with Donald Trump. But when you look at this campaign, I want to remind you of some extraordinarily hopeful things. You know, this country in 2007, as a result of Wall Street excess, the economy went off the cliff, and Main Street was drowning. We were losing 800,000 jobs a year, a month. We were losing 800,000 jobs a month. And this was the biggest recession, if you want to call it that, since the Depression. And we elected President Obama, and we did things that started turning it around. And we did things like Obamacare when I was in the House. We did Dodd-Frank. We did the auto bailout, which was every single one of these things was criticized. And we wished folks like Bernie and me and Patrick that we could have had fewer tax breaks in the Recovery Act, more infrastructure. We wish we could have had the equivalent of a modern Glass-Steagall and Dodd-Frank. But the fact is the things we did made a difference and it started to stabilize the economy. I was in the majority. I was part of that. We passed in the House the Waxman-Markey climate change bill. We didn't quite make it through the Senate, as you guys know, but 40% of the emission reductions were going to come from the efficiency provisions that were really inspired by what Vermonters had done here. And I literally just took what we did here and gave it to Mr. Waxman, and we put it in there. That was Vermonters. So it was there. Now, we paid a price because there was a huge reaction in 2010. And the House majority that I was part of for 4 years got wiped out. And in that same year, we had something happen that, in my view, is as bad as the Citizens United. It's the radical gerrymandering of our districts where there is no prospect for somebody to be elected in any of these districts, whether they're conservative or they're liberal or progressive, where they also have in them a gene that says, if you're in the legislature, you're there to govern. You're there to act. You're there to listen. You're there to make progress. Fight your fight. So we've got a situation right now. And we were unsuccessful in getting us back to some of the things that happened after the Great Depression, where there were institutions created and strengthened that even the hand of labor and working people, so that when profits went up, wages went up with them. And we had, in the last 4 or 5 years, moments where the stock market was never higher and wages as a percentage of profits were never lower. So the pain that Bernie talked about, that two-tier economy, it wasn't a tale of two economies. It was a tale of the 1% and everybody else. That did not happen by accident. That was policies, trade deals that were bad in terms of what it did to wages, even as it increased profits. It was bad in terms of environmental safeguards, where you could cut corners at the expense of what you did to people's health. It was bad in the sense of weakening labor, so they didn't have a seat at the table to fight for legitimate wages and working conditions for their people. That's the situation we're in now. And it was a philosophy that's been adopted in this new Republican Party where you're on your own. You're on your own. In pharmaceutical companies that don't invest, but they just buy up a product, they can raise the price 500%. They make billions of dollars in profits. Their executives make tens of millions of dollars in salary. And what do? They take that company from the United States and move it to the Netherlands so they don't even have to pay taxes for their share of the roads and the bridges and the education that made it possible for them to do what they did. So when I think about this, that's the circumstances we're in. But when I think about this presidential election, and I think about 18 months ago, and I remember the Democrats had a candidate, it was Hillary Clinton, who was so dominant that it looked like she was going to clear the field. There wasn't going to be a primary. But there was a man in Vermont. Now listen, it's interesting. There was a man in Vermont who had this stirring in his soul, and that stirring was he was going to practice democracy. And practicing democracy was he was going to talk to one person at a time. He was going to tell them the truth as he saw it. He was going to ask them to join with him in that movement. He was calling it a revolution because he was indicting the status quo. And that person, who was seen at the outset of this campaign as being on less than a quixotic campaign, became the individual in the United States of America who has had more impact on politics in this country, in this election, than any other individual in the United States, and that man is Bernie Sanders. Well, you know, it's true. You know, everyone, before Bernie had that Secret Service deal going with him, I used to talk with him on the plane. And I remember he was like, you know, he was thinking he might have to raise $50 million. Little light. It was well over $200 million. All those votes, all that inspiration, all the people here and around who got involved in Bernie. I think Vermonters showed their pride in you when 86%, I don't know how you lost a few, 86% at the primary voted for Bernie Sanders. And I want to say two more things about that. You know, we have a better Democratic platform. And a lot of times people say platforms don't matter. They matter, okay? And Hillary Clinton did a wise thing. She didn't repudiate Bernie. She embraced Bernie's agenda. She embraced it. Now, we've got work to do when we get back down to Washington to stay true to that agenda that was so powerfully advocated by Bernie. But that mattered. Your support for Bernie mattered. Bernie's campaign mattered. That was practicing democracy, and we have an election, but after that election, we have work to do. That's what it's all about. So let's hang in there on that. The second thing I want to say, you know, the House is a mess right now. And it's so bad that, you know, look, I've got, it's a pretty good job. You know what I mean? But people sort of feel bad for me. But, you know, I don't feel bad for myself, and I'll tell you why. I'm a Vermonter. You know, some people are teachers and have tough classes. Some folks are mechanics, and car comes in, and it's a wreck, and you don't know how you're going to fix it, and the person's not going to be able to pay you what you're going to have to put into it. Some people are farmers, and the weather never cooperates. But you know what a Vermonter does? They just deal with it. They just wake up, put their shoes on, let's roll. Let's do what needs to be done. And I liked being in the majority much better because we were acting on health care, on Dodd-Frank, on economic development, on climate change. We need that. And my job now is to defend against the rollback. But you know what? The decision each of us makes when it comes to practicing democracy is we're going to face the world as it is and change it for the better, not complain about the situation we're in and pull the covers over our head. So I'm enjoying my job because I have an opportunity to make a difference that you want made every single day. So thank you for letting me do this job. And now we've got a chance to elect this woman governor, and we're going to do it. And Sue, You're up to the challenge, but I want to remind you why it's a big challenge. All of us as Vermonters, whether we're running for governor, serving as a United States Senator or not, we have big shoes to fill in this state. You know, you do know, our Constitution, we're the 14th state, we banned slavery. We were the first state where women voted. We had our young men coming off the farms in greater percentages joining the Union cause than any other northern state, and we lost more lives than any other northern state. When it came to marriage equality, this state was the first legislature that voted that who you loved is who you could marry. That's... But you know, it's what we do. It's what we do. So all of us are filling shoes of giants who went before us when all of those were contentious and difficult and challenging issues. Do you face them or do you flee from them? We Vermonters face them, and it's our job, and Sue Minter is going to be our leader to do it. And what she knows and understands, and this is, again, it's like an emotional orientation in life. All right, climate change is a problem. And I hear a lot of people say, look, the world's going to end. But I hear a lot of other people say, we're going to fight this. We're going to find a way to make it better. And in the doing of that effort, in making it better, we're actually going to create jobs. We're going to improve incomes. And incidentally, we're going to save the planet from carbon emissions. That's what Vermonters do. They just deal with it. And we've got a woman who's ready to deal with it. So let us elect Sue Minter, our next governor. Thank you all very much.
Now, I've known the next guy I'm going to introduce, for 30 or 40 years. We've worked together when I was Mayor of Burlington in the House, and we see each other every day in the Senate. Pat Leahy has been a leader in this country and certainly in our state in the struggle for civil liberties and the struggle for privacy, in the fight for organic agriculture, as chairman of the Senate Judiciary Committee, he has done his very best to make sure that we have the best Supreme Court that we can have. And on all of the major social issues, the issues of women's rights and gay rights, Pat Leahy has been a leader. Let's welcome Senator Pat Leahy.
Thank you. Thanks, Bernie. And, you know, it is fascinating being there in the Senate with Bernie, and I'm going to speak a little bit more about that in a moment. I'm not going to speak long because you've heard many speeches, but I would point out that some congressional delegations have 40 or 50 or more members between their two senators and all their House members. The Vermont delegation can meet anytime we want. We can meet in Bernie's office or my office or Peter's office. Sometimes we meet in the elevator. And it works because we come out, we have a pretty powerful united voice. I'm glad to be here tonight. My sister Mary, who's in the back row, she and I, born, raised here along with our brother in Montpelier. We lived in a house that is now the Arts Council, Vermont, our Council of the Arts on 136 State Street. I lived there from the time I was born until I met a beautiful young woman from Burlington, Vermont. My wife, Marcel, was here. We got married, and we have lived in this area ever since. Our home is now in Middlesex. But anybody here from Middlesex? Be sure you get out and vote. I want a good, strong vote in Middlesex. I told Bernie in private, came back to the Senate to a rousing cheer from the Democratic caucus, and then again at a special event we had for the retiring leader of the Democrats in the Senate, how glad I was to have him back, because we need him. We need his voice. We need his conscience. We need the fact that he'll speak up when others have been afraid to. Let me tell you just one area in which we need this. The Supreme Court. Never in the history of this country has anybody done the unconstitutional thing that the Republican leader has done in not allowing a vote on a Supreme Court justice, something he announced 2 hours after the death of Antonin Scalia. He said there will be no vote. Baloney. That's not the Constitution. The Constitution says the president shall nominate. It says the president shall nominate. Well, President Obama did. He nominated a man who, by all counts, eminently qualified, Merrick Garland, to be on the U.S. Supreme Court. But there's one other thing that each one of the 100 U.S. senators has taken an oath, say that they shall uphold the Constitution, so help me God. Where are these God-fearing people when they won't follow the oath they made? And that's why the Republican leader has said he wants more Republican senators so that he can keep that position. We had one member of his Republican caucus announce the other day publicly, if Hillary Clinton is elected and we Republicans are in the majority, we won't allow any Supreme Court justices. That is outrageous. I want you to know, and I obviously have a stake in this, when you vote for me, because let's show them we don't send a Republican so they can stop the Supreme Court. We won't do it. But I want, on January 3rd, I want Bernie Sanders and I standing there in a newly led Senate. I will bow to him as Chairman Sanders, and he'll say something nice to me. But then we can set the agenda. And one agenda is going to be to bring the courts back to straight, to bring courts that will represent all of us, to bring courts that will bring the honor and dignity to the courts that we expect, that will allow everybody who goes before the court to think they will have a fair hearing, not a hearing dictated by the Republican leader in the U.S. Senate. We cannot do that. And we'll keep the organic farm bill going. So the stakes are high. Now, Bernie spoke throughout his campaign and continues to about what is best in America. Look at Donald Trump. He believes in America only if he accepts your religion or your race or your country of origin. For shame. For shame. We judge people on their race, their country of origin, their religion? He does. We don't. Why? Because we are Americans, and we know we have a great country. And we are a great country because of our diversity. Because of it. Not in spite of it, but because of it. And they talk about it. Not long ago, some of the people, including this child we saw in the ambulance covered with blood, coming in here from Syria. What if Steve Jobs' father, when he wanted to come in here from Syria, had been sought, would we have Apple today? I mean, think of what's happened. Or Mary, our grandparents, when they came from Italy and began a stone carving business in South Reigate, Vermont. Or our other grandfather, who was a stone carver in Barrie, Vermont, our Irish grandfather. You know, we believe in that diversity, as does Bernie. So, it's not just at the national level. I will fight for your values, as I always have. And I will honor your trust if you reelect me. But I'm also a lifelong Vermonter. And I care about who we have here. I want you to elect Sue Minter as governor. And I'll tell you why. She knows how to get things done. She knows how to create green jobs. We worked with her, all of us, after the devastation of Irene. I knew I could call my fellow members of the Appropriations Committee and ask for money, but I knew that Sue would make sure it was spent in a way that we could trust to get more money. Anyone impacted by that tropical storm Irene will tell you, Sue delivers. She gets things done. This morning, Marcel and I invited Sue to join us with one of my old colleagues from the Senate, Joe Biden, for breakfast in Burlington. We had a wonderful discussion. Yeah. The Vice President was here. The Vice President was here to speak about his cancer moonshot. To him, it's very personal, but he also knows that we can do far better. He lost his son, Bo, whom we knew very well, to cancer. My sister and I lost our brother just a few months ago to cancer. Marcel's a cancer survivor. This means a lot. But I also wanted to see how we run Vermont. And he had such a great conversation with Sue Minter. And she was telling him what her views were, what she wanted to do for the state. And soon after you had to leave, and Marcel and I were in the car with the Vice President, he turned to me and he said, "You two really like Sue Minter, don't you?" I said, "Joe, we're Vermonters. We live here. We want the best." He says, "I think you got the best. So make sure we elect her." And send me back, please, so that Bernie and I can try to bring some sense into some in the United States Senate, and knowing that we're always going to be the tough backup with Peter Welch in the other body. So thank you all very, very much.
Thank you, Pat. Sue mentioned a bit earlier about the role that big money and dark money and Koch brothers money is playing in undermining our democracy. And if you ask me, the most serious issue facing this country It is the fact that, in my view, we are moving toward an oligarchic form of society where a handful of billionaires not only control the economy, they now want to buy the government. And the antidote to that, the only antidote I know, is grassroots democracy, where people are prepared to stand up to the Koch brothers and Sheldon Adelson and the other billionaires and tell them, no, they're not going to buy the United States government, and they're not going to buy the government of the state of Vermont. And when we do that, we will have the opportunity with Peter and Pat and myself to go down again to Washington and overturn this disastrous Citizens United Supreme Court decision. All over this country, there are a lot of people who are giving up on democracy. They're in trouble, they're hurting, they don't see government representing their needs, they see government representing wealthy campaign contributors. Our job in this state is not only to stand up and protect working families and the elderly and the children and the sick and the poor, it is to show the entire country what a vibrant democracy is about. One person, one vote. So while it is true the Koch brothers and the other billionaires have unlimited sums of money, we have something that they don't have, and that something is in this room today. It is thousands of people in the state of Vermont who in the next 2.5 weeks are going to work as hard as they possibly can to elect and re-elect this wonderful slate of candidates we have right here. So thank you all. Thank you all very much for being out tonight. Let's go forward. Thank you.